getting started, I want to give us an update on our 2020 Giving Back Christmas event. Let me tell you, I am still on the cloud, just reeling from this event. We had such a blessing, such a fun time. We have already got it scheduled for next year. It was such a big event, and it's not too early to put it on your calendar. Save the date already, November the 14th, 2021. Mark it down if you wasn't able to join us this past couple of weeks. Listen, come out next year. As stressful as it was organizing it and planning it and just setting it up, the blessings far exceeded that. Just to get out of what's going on in this world and get together with your friends and family and people you don't know and just having fellowship together for a good cause. It was so much fun. The kids had a blast. I just want to thank God for taking this event and just blessing us, and that He will bring it back down so that we can share this blessing with others. Listen, there's so many children in the hospital. We just celebrated Thanksgiving, did we not? We had our friends over, we had our family over. We're right here starting Christmas, bringing in the decorations, getting our tree put up. There's people at the hospital that's not getting to share this, that's not getting to celebrate. They're there with their daughters or their sons or their grandchildren, and they're just hoping for another day with them. Listen, you've made it possible to relieve some of that stress on them through your giving. And I don't take that for granted. It's not something, a small amount. This is huge when people are going through something like this. You make it possible. I'm so thankful for you and for that. Well, I knew I was going to get teared up. I want to thank my family for loading up trucks, for unloading trucks, for setting up. Listen, I've stressed them out too, and I think they still love me. I think they do. Thank our friends. We have people volunteering, you know, what can I do? Let me help. Just a blessing. Blessing. Our partners. Not just so blessed, but 3 Oaks Farm. Listen, their venue is beautiful. If you got to see it, Marsha and Dennis, great people. You'll not meet nicer people if it weren't for them giving us their venue, donating their time and their place. And we couldn't have pulled this off. And the same with Barn Doors and More. I'm telling you, Christy and Brent, they're amazing. Amazing Christian people just coming together for one cause. We want to touch a little bit on partnerships. And our lesson today, go ahead and turn to your Bible, to Philemon, but just to let you know an update on the amount that we received just from this event, we were able to raise $8,411.45. Glory to God. So at the end of the year, we're going to be writing Choa a check to the family fund at the PICU. We already have money that was donated prior into the account. My goal for this year was at $10,000. I really hope that we could make $10,000. Listen, we've got $12,000 in the account already. And it's not too late to donate. You can go to our SoBlessedMinistry.org website. Scroll down to the bottom. Your donation options are at the bottom of the page. If you wasn't able to come to our event, you still have an opportunity to donate. Listen, it will be greatly appreciated. Thank y'all so much. I do want to give out a shout out to our business sponsors that helped make this possible as well. Bees, as in, I don't know his last name more, but I'm going to say B for Bagley. But Bees, Wood Creations, the Assisting Hands Home Care, for Scythe Truck Sales, Evans Record Service, Bagley Commercial Properties, Blue Mountain Mechanical, 20 Degrees South, Georgia Computer Incorporated, Cody Sweat with Homestar, Lauren Freeman Photography. Those are our business sponsors this year. If y'all are interested in doing a business sponsor next year, we've got time. We'll be contacting you. And if you don't hear from us, please send me an email, shoot me a text, whatever, saying y'all are interested. But thank you again so much for all your work and your prayers and your support. But let's go to the Lord in prayer before we get into our lesson this morning. Father, we just thank you for this morning, for letting us share your word together and with others. And thank you for the blessings that you have bestowed upon us. My heart is just overflow. It's just overflowing. I'm just rejoicing, and I'm so thankful for you, for my family and friends, and for my fellow Christians, brothers and sisters. Thank you, Lord. Guide us always in our work for you and in our daily lives. Just keep your arms wrapped around us and just bless us. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our lesson this morning, and I don't think it's a coincidence. I follow a lesson plan, a guide, and this just happened to be on partnerships. Now, how convenient is that? That we're just talking about partnering and coming together to work for the Lord, and our lesson this morning just happens to be on partnerships in a way of a runaway slave. The lesson title is Grace to a Runaway Slave. In Paul's short letter to Philemon, it's only 25 verses long, but Paul made an appeal for oneness and unity in Jesus Christ, and he placed himself in the middle of a broken relationship between Philemon, a slave owner, and Onesimus, a slave. But contained within that story of reconciliation and grace is the gospel itself, and we want to touch on that towards the end of our lesson. But there's one thing that I want you to take away from this lesson this morning, and that's Christian unity is not about sameness. It's about oneness. Oneness. There's something I want us to address. I guess you could say the elephant in the room that needs to be addressed when we're thinking about and talking about slavery. Is that first century slavery, what it was and what it wasn't? It's tempting to read Paul's letter to Philemon in light of our own 21st century American context of slavery. For us, the word, it triggers in our minds the evil of racial superiority, the cotton fields of the South, the whipping post, the selling of families at the slave market. It's disgusting and despicable. But slavery in the first century in the Roman Empire wasn't based on skin color. The idea of racial profiling or racial reconciliation, it would have seemed strange to Paul. He reminded the Galatians, there is no Jew or Greek, slave or free, male or female, for you are all one in Christ. Now, when Paul wrote his letter to Philemon, about two-thirds of the people in the Roman Empire were slaves. Shipwrecked sailors would become slaves. Prisoners of defeated cities would become slaves. Even celebrity heroes would become slaves, and they were forced into gladiatorial combat. But beyond that, anybody in the Roman Empire could voluntarily indenture themselves to a master to become a slave. Some became enslaved to pay off debts. or generate revenue. Highly educated slaves were often used as school teachers for small children in the Roman families. But masters didn't always treat their slaves well, of course, and Paul addressed that problem in Ephesus, chapter 6. Slaves sometimes rebelled, organizing uprisings, robbed or stole, or occasionally escaped. Now, Paul instructed that the Christians who were enslaved in Colossae to obey their human masters in everything. Don't only work, he says, being watched as people pleasers, but work wholeheartedly, fearing the Lord. Let's look at Paul's letter here. We're going to try to get through all the verses. Let's start with his greeting, verse 1. Paul, a prisoner of Christ Jesus, and Timothy, our brother, to Philemon, our beloved friend and fellow laborer, to the beloved Alpha, now this is his wife, and Archippus, his son, our fellow soldiers, and to the church in your house. Grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God, making mention of you always in my prayers, hearing of your love and faith, which you have towards the Lord Jesus and towards all the saints, that the sharing of your faith may become effective by the acknowledgement of every good thing which is in you in Christ Jesus. For we have great joy and consolation in your love, because the hearts of the saints have been refreshed by you, brother. Have you ever been in a partnership with someone? We talked about that earlier with our ministry. We're even partnerships with people. But have you ever been in a partnership, maybe business dealings or partnership or even personal? And sometimes there may be, may not always be an agreement on which way that partnership should go, or there may be conflicting thoughts or ideas. It may have been conflicting ideas about how Philemon felt when he got this letter from his senior partner. Now, partnership is a key to the whole letter, and Paul plays on it for all it's worth. Actually, the word that he uses for partnership is often translated as fellowship. But there's something like a partnership that's going on that is linking Paul and Philemon and the others, and they're in this together. They share a joint project, and if it's to go forward, then they must be prepared to stand together, side by side. Now, Philemon lives in Colossae. It's roughly about 100 miles inland from Ephesus. And the letter to the Colossians was being sent there at the same time. And he had become a Christian, it seemed, through hearing Paul's preach, presumably, I can't even get that word out this morning. When Philemon was visiting Ephesus, Paul at this stage, he had not been to Colossae itself. He was still working in Ephesus. But Paul had been thrilled with the way that Philemon, a man of some means and influence, had responded to the gospel. It gripped his heart and made him a man of love and generosity. And he and his wife and his son had joined Paul in the work of the gospel. And they had gone home to Colossae and made their home a place of love and hospitality, where a handful of the Christians had in the area had begun to meet and have church. But now Paul had a problem on his hands, and like every other person in the world of substance, Philemon had owned slaves. And to them, this was as natural as us owning a car or a television as it is for us today. But to us, of course, slavery is despicable. It's horrible. It's just unimaginable. But to them, it was like electricity or gas or cars. You couldn't imagine a society without it. And suggesting that you should get rid of it altogether was about as realistically as somebody suggesting today that we should abandon those electric appliances or cars or airplanes and so on. But one of Philemon's slaves had run away, and that in his world was a capital offense, and many owners would take severe vengeance against them. Now, we don't know how Onesimus had ended up in Ephesus, but he had met Paul, and that's where his story really took off. The slave's name was Onesimus. Now, this is a Greek name, so it's pronounced with the E separately. Now, I don't know about you, but the Bible is full of names that I cannot in my southern slang pronounce or even get anywhere close. So I write down when I come to them out to the side how it's pronounced. So I'm going to just give you a quick of how it's pronounced. If you'll take your pen to just write somewhere a note on it, put O-W-N-E-E-S-I-M-U-S, Onesimus. Hopefully that'll help. If nobody else outside this classroom knows what we're talking about, at least me and you know who Onesimus is. And the name, ironically enough, means useful, which precisely he had not been to Philemon. But Onesimus had come now under Paul's influence. Perhaps he had sought him out, having heard the family speak favorably of Paul, and he had become a Christian, so eagerly to embrace the faith, and so grateful was he to Paul for telling him about Jesus that he had started to look after Paul in prison and to attend to his needs with the devotion that he never showed his real master. He and Paul had become friends, brothers, and the Lord Jesus, and close partners in the gospel. But Paul couldn't shield Onesimus from what had to happen next, and nor could he shield Philemon from it. He was going to make huge demands on both of them, and like a chairman of a company, he was going to come up with a proposal that his partners were instinctively resist or even perhaps resent. But he was going to send Onesimus back to Philemon and ask Philemon to accept him back without any penalty and perhaps even hint at Onesimus being set free. But everything in that society was against it. You can imagine the feelings on both sides. If everybody did that, the world would just grind to a halt. Philemon would be the laughing stock of all his friends. If runaway slaves get rewarded with freedom, then they'd all want to do it. Now, Paul knew all the arguments of this, but he outflanked them with the gospel message of Jesus, the Lord, before whom he and Philemon and Onesimus and all the others were themselves slaves and household servants. But the key sentence in this passage, and in the middle of all the fine things Paul has said about Philemon, is verse 6. So highlight that and underline that. I want you to take note of it. This is what he's praying for. Now, often when Paul tells people what he's praying for, when he thinks of them, it gives us a clue to the inner meaning of his letter. And here he's praying that the partnership which he and Philemon share in the gospel will be productive and will have the effect that it's meant to have. And when people believe the gospel, they are brought into a partnership with all the others who believe it. And they are members of the board in this business. And the partnership must have a powerful effect. When two or more work together in the service of the gospel, new things happen. Things previously thought impossible. This is what all partners want. And when Paul puts it like this, Philemon will be agreeing with him. Now, whether he still agrees with him when he sees what Paul has in mind is another matter altogether. But the opening statement has been made. Paul has laid the foundation. And let's look at verses 8 through 14. Therefore, I might be very bold in Christ to command you what is fitting, yet for love's sake, I'd rather appeal to you, because such as one is Paul, the aged, and now also a prisoner of Jesus Christ, I appeal to you for my son, Onesimus, whom I have begotten while in my chains, who once was unprofitable to you, but now is profitable to you and to me. I am sending him back. You therefore receive him, that is, my own heart, whom I wish to keep with me, but on your behalf, that you might minister to me in my chains for the gospel. But without your consent, I wanted to do nothing, that your good deed might not be by compulsion, as it were, but voluntary. Now, Paul knows the dangers of trying to force somebody into doing something, and his style throughout this whole letter is one of a gentle, almost playful Christian persuasion. He knows Philemon well enough to adapt the right tone to take with him. And what he's going to ask is very, very difficult. But he is reasonably sure that Philemon will take the point and will act on it. But just to be sure, he takes it step by step. So first, he builds a secure foundation, the relationship which he and Philemon have. Then he names the person at the center of the problem. Then he quickly makes clear that when Philemon is confronted with Onesimus himself, he is actually looking at Paul. Now, this is the heart of his strategy in this really skillful letter that he is writing. The relationship between Paul and Philemon is itself that of a father-son or a preacher-convert relationship. Philemon had come to faith through Paul's preaching. And Paul appeals to him on one of love. He appeals to his love, his sympathy, his affection, and describing himself as an old man in prison. Now, Paul probably wasn't what we would call very old today. Quite possibly he was only in his 40s or 50s, but in the world where life expectancy was much lower than what we have today, he would be seen as a senior figure and with a natural claim on Philemon's respect. And that claim now extends because, having established that he and Philemon are bonded together with several strands of love and partnership, affection, and respect, he is now going to show that he and Onesimus have established a similar bond. Onesimus is his child, he says. He has become a Christian through Paul's teaching and his love. Now, Paul, he quite often refers to such people as his children. He's done it in 1 Corinthians and Galatians 4, his children. And like a fond parent sending his son or your daughter off out into the world, Paul sends Onesimus to Colossae, and he's sending his very heart, he's saying. But the point is now clear when, to his surprise, Philemon discovers that Onesimus, his very own runaway slave, has returned. Paul doesn't want him just to see Onesimus standing there. He wants him to see Paul himself. That is the foundation of the appeal Paul is making as the letter reaches its climax in the next section. But what we are watching here is a living example of Christian practice of reconciliation. Now let's look at verses 15 through 20. Let's just go to 22. We'll not do the last three. Those are farewells, and you can just read those. Start at 15. For perhaps he departed for a while for this purpose, that you might receive him forever, no longer as a slave, but more than a slave, a beloved brother, especially to me, but how much more to you, both in the flesh and in the Lord. If then you count me as a partner, receive him as you would me. But if he has wronged you or owes you anything, put that on my account. I, Paul, am writing with my own hand. I will repay, not to mention that you owe me even your own self besides. Yes, brother, let me have joy from you in the Lord. Refresh my heart in the Lord. Let me God cannot overlook a broken heart. He collects them. He tends them. He mends them. But through the cracks of a broken spirit, listen, the Holy Spirit enters. And it just distributes grace to every limb. Paul had a broken heart when he penned this letter. A heart that Philemon could heal by demonstrating the grace of God to Onesimus. Refresh my heart in Christ, he instructed. Having confidence in your obedience, I write to you knowing that you will do even more than I say. But meanwhile, also prepare a guest room for me, for I trust that through your prayers, I shall be granted to you. I like to look back at the beginning of God's story, all the way at the beginning of our story in Genesis, and watch how God paints the picture of the universe and his creation and of us. He is an artist, and we are the painting. If you go, you know these verses. You don't probably have to even go back and read, but in the beginning, God. And in 6 days, he's created his creation. And each time he'll draw maybe the sky or the waters, and he'll step back and he'll say, oh, that's good. And then he'll draw some birds or some fish on his canvas, and he'll step back and he'll say, oh, that's good. But sometimes it seems in our life that God will take a paint pot, fill it up with paint, and hurl it at the canvas from the other side of the room, and then he'll stand back and look at it and say to himself, now, that looks interesting. What might we do next? Listen, we can't very often look at the details in our lives and see exactly where we fit in the larger plan of God. But from time to time, if we watch in faith and in trust, we can glimpse sometimes of what God is about and what that divine painter has in mind. Paul is virtually certain of what Philemon must do now, but he is still restrained enough to insert the all-important maybe in front of what is perhaps the most important sentence in this letter. I want you to look at verse 15. Now, I use the New King James Version. I don't know what version you are using or what your wording is, but Paul is saying, mine says, for perhaps. What Paul said is supposing. He says, just suppose God had a purpose, not just for you at this moment, but even the fact that Onesimus ran away in the first place. Now, isn't that extraordinary? And he tactfully doesn't refer to the running away itself, merely to Onesimus being separated from you. God moves in mysterious ways. As Jesus says about the Spirit, it's like the wind. You can hear it, but you can't tell where it's coming from, maybe, or where it's going to. So now maybe God has been secretly at work, even though what seemed like sad and unfortunate and wicked human actions in order to bring about a situation which would shine his light not only on Colossae but around the whole world. We talked about the gospel at the first within the message. Listen, God can work through things which are themselves wicked and unhappy. Yes, he can. And the greatest act of rescuing love God ever did, he did it in person with the death of Jesus on the cross. Throughout all the New Testament, all this is put together so that the cross of Jesus becomes the point of which God, in sovereign love, takes up the pain and sin of the world and deals with it himself. That, in fact, is precisely what Paul had in mind in this passage. He doesn't mention the cross here, rather he applies it. On the cross, listen, picture the painting that Paul is painting here. Picture it with me. On the cross, Jesus hung with arms outstretched between heaven and earth, making a bridge up between God and the human race, and from side to side between all the warring factions of earth. And Paul has grasped the truth that so many have missed. His achievements of reconciliation is put into effect when people follow the same pattern. When people allow the cross to shape their own lives, the love of God is set free to change and heal in ways that we can't even imagine. So you see what Paul's done. He's established that he and Philemon are partners in the gospel. That is to say that they share a common life, common goals, a common way of life. But now he's also established that he and Onesimus, too, are bonded together in Christian love. So what is the result? If it's a case that Philemon has every legal right to be angry with Onesimus, to punish him, and to perhaps even kill him, what is the result? It will be Paul standing between them. He will represent them to one another. He will substitute for Onesimus. He will pay Philemon. Look at verse 19. Paul, taking the quill and digging a little bit deeper into the parchment, he writes, and he's telling him precisely not what he's going to remind him of, but he says, "You too, Philemon, you owe me." Paul will stand in the place of risk and pain with arms outstretched towards the slave and the owner. And he will close the gap, not just between Philemon and Onesimus, but between two sides of the great divine that run through this whole world. Paul, firmly rooted in the saving gospel of the cross of Jesus, is, as Paul says in Second Corinthians, entrusted with the gospel of reconciliation. This is what it looks like in practice. What Paul asks for is that Onesimus be accepted back into Philemon's household, both in his former job and as a brother in Christ. But he hints at something beyond that in addition to. Look at verse 21. "I know," he says, "that even you will do more than I say." This can only refer to giving Onesimus his freedom. And like the prodigal son who only asked to be hired back as a servant in his own father's household, he is to be given an astonishing welcome of a son. Where in your world, in your church, in your family, in your workplace, where is the healing and restoration grace of God most needed? How can God's people stand in the middle of the picture, holding out your arms to people on either side, bringing them closer together after them being divided by large or small disputes or arguments or whatever it may be? Are you ready to be peacemakers and reconcilers in the name of Jesus? Where do you stand? Listen, could your name be inserted in verse 21? Let's look back at that. Listen, having confidence in your obedience, Christy, I write to you, knowing that you will do even more than I say. Could that be said about me? Could that be said about you? Having confidence in your obedience and insert yourself. Can that be said about you? Listen. We are partnerships in the gospel of Christ, and we are here to advance His kingdom, His way. Let Him guide you this week. Ponder on these words this week. Stay praying, stay hopeful, and stay in this word. I love y'all.